Every Man His Own University by Russell H. Conwell, narrated by Trevor O'Hare. Chapter 1. Every Man's University. A distinct university walks about under each man's hat. The only man who achieves success in the other universities of the world, and in the larger university of life, is the man who has first taken his graduate course and his postgraduate course in the university under his hat. There, observation furnishes a daily change in the curriculum. Books are not the original sources of power, but observation, which may bring to us all wide experience, deep thinking, fine feeling, and the power to act for oneself, is the very dynamo of power. Without observation, literature and meditation are shower and sunshine upon unbroken soil. Only those schools and colleges are true schools and colleges, which regard it as the chief business of all their teaching to persuade those under their charge to see more perfectly what they are looking at, to find what they should have been unable to observe had it not been for their school instruction. You can't make a good arrow from a pig's tail, and you can seldom get a man worthwhile out of one who has gone through the early part of his life without having learned to be alert when things are to be seen or heard. John Stuart Blackie says that it is astonishing how much we all go about with our eyes wide open and see nothing, and Dr. Johnson says that some men shall see more while riding 10 miles upon the top of an omnibus than some others shall see in riding over the continent. How to observe should be the motto, not only in the beginning of our life, but throughout our career. With the same intellectual gifts, interested in the same ideas, two men walk side by side through the same scenery and meet the same people. One man has had much inspiration from the country traversed, and has been intent upon all that he has seen and heard among the people. The other has caught no inspiration from beauty or bird or blossom, and only the trivialities of the people have amused him. A traveler in Athens or Rome, Paris or London, may be shown these cities by a professional guide, and yet gain only a smattering of what these cities hold in store for him, and remember little of what he has seen. Another traveler, unattended by a guide, but observant of everything that comes to his eyes and ears, will carry away stores from his visit to those cities, which shall be of lifelong interest and be serviceable to all who shall travel his way. The solitary but observant stranger in a country almost always profits most from his travels. He is compelled to notice boulevards and buildings, parks and people, and every day of his travels is a lesson in observation that accustoms him to remember all he has once seen. The newspaper correspondents of other days had no guidebooks or guides, and they were entire strangers in the places they visited. They relied entirely upon themselves to find their way, and to discover everything that was valuable and interesting. They found much that the modern guide either overlooks or disregards, and wrote for the papers at home what would most interest and instruct their readers. When Henry M. Stanley first visited Jerusalem, he insisted that the dragoman in charge of his party should keep all guides and guidebooks out of his sight. In 2 days, Stanley knew the streets and the location of the temple and the Holy Sepulchre and all the notable places in that old city. If Stanley is today known as one of the most intelligent of travelers, it is mainly because he excelled in daily observation, which everyone who thinks for himself recognizes as the supreme acquisition of a liberal education. He often said that he knew Rome, Naples, and Vienna far better than he knew New York, where he had lived many years of his life, in that he resembled the rest of humanity, who generally know less about what is notable in their home places than observant visitors know who stay there only a short time during their travels. What we pay for in time and labor seems more valuable. Nothing pay, nothing value. A great foreign correspondent of his day, Henry W. Chambers, remained only 6 hours at Baalbek, near Damascus, yet he wrote the clearest description that probably ever was written of the magnificent temples at Baalbek. And he wrote these descriptions, too, at Hong Kong, after many and varied experiences while visiting other places of greater importance. Many archaeologists and literary men, before him, had visited the moat of the great fortress at Baalbek. Still, they had never observed as Chambers observed, and so they missed seeing the arrowheads and all the other warlike instruments used in those ancient days, which had lain unnoticed among those huge pillars and great foundation stones. Although General Lew Wallace lived a long time at Jerusalem, he only imagined that there might have been an inner dungeon underneath the great prison. So when he wrote Ben-Hur, he put his leprous heroine into this imaginary prison house. A schoolteacher from northern England with her tourist candle afterward found the doorway of this prison which Wallace had only imagined to be there. On their way from Egypt and Palestine to the Euphrates, travelers had for centuries passed over the same path in the desert, but it was reserved for a cutter of marble inscriptions. After all these centuries, to observe the Rosetta Stone, by the help of which archaeologists can now read the inscriptions upon the tablets in the ancient palaces of Babylon and Nineveh. Millions and millions had seen the lid of a tea kettle bobbing up and down over the boiling water before that Scotchman, Watt, observed it while making watches. But he was the first of all those millions whose close observation led him to investigate this force of boiling water in the tea kettle. Then he applied this power to the steam engine, which is still the great propelling force of the world. From the time of the Garden of Eden, apples had fallen in the orchards of the world through all the harvest days. Of all the billions that had seen apples falling, only Sir Isaac Newton observed the law of gravitation that was involved in their falling. All the great discoverers began with nearly the same meager powers for observation that the rest of the world has, but early in life came to value above all other mental powers this incalculable power to closely notice, and each made his realm of observation much richer for his discoveries. Why do the majority of us go through life seeing nothing of the millions of marvelous truths and facts?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.